Yeah, both my grandfathers did not serve in World War II. They were 4F. My father served a little bit in the reserves, Navy Reserve, so I didn't have that big of a military background in the family. My uncle served in Vietnam, as well as a cousin who was lost to the family during the war. So I guess my uncle was the reason that I thought maybe of joining the Army and was my inspiration for becoming a service member. Yeah, I went to college and actually decided to major in government international studies so that I thought the classes would be interesting enough to keep me going to class. The more I learned about the world, the more it seemed like maybe the military was a pretty decent idea for a way to contribute. I actually worked for Senator Thurmond after my senior year of college and still hadn't totally made up my mind about my career, even after graduating. Looked at possibly the Foreign Service and possibly even some other civilian jobs, but and looking at the different options, it looked like the military was probably the best way to both serve my country and still have a pretty decent career without like eating and drinking with the natives on a Friday night while you're out with a Peace Corps, for instance. Yeah, the springtime of 1979, which was about a year after I graduated college, I was actually living in Columbia, South Carolina at the time with some of my old college buddies. Grabbed my shaving kit, walked into the front gate of Fort Jackson, and entered into the life of the Army, an experience that I really didn't have any idea of what I was walking into. Turned out that the food was better, the barracks were better, the drill sergeant was tougher. The friends were close, and the first few weeks, of course, of basic training, you're not going to have a good time. You never were meant to have a good time. But certainly by the end of basic training, you knew your drill sergeant, you knew your fellow soldiers in your unit like you knew your own brothers, and it wound up being, in memory, a very good experience, much more so than Officer Candidate School, which was my next stop. Yeah, Officer Candidate School is a very unique experience. The first letter I wrote to my parents, I actually the first line was, "I wish I was a prisoner of war," because I'm sure as a prisoner of a war, you are left alone for at least a few minutes during the day. You are pretty much under a time stress from about 4:55 in the morning till about 10 o'clock at night. It seemed that the purpose of the tactical officers over you wasn't so much to train you as it was to see how many of you they could run off of the out of the class. Our class, and that was the 50th Company, and it started in spring of 79. I'm sorry, it was in the summer of 79. That class started with 220 gentlemen, men and women, and by the time we graduated, we were down to 129. So it's when you go through it, it's like an experience you wish everybody had to go through. Armor, yeah, the way that as far as you offering your preference for branch assignment, they would allow you five choices. You'd pick number one to number five. I actually did not have armor on mine. I had, I think it was a military intelligence, then the Chemical Corps, Adjutant General's Corps, infantry. I didn't have armor. Apparently, it was my sixth choice, but it worked out well for both the Army and for myself. Entering into an armor, the first unit I went to was in Fort Lewis, Washington, and we immediately went out training as soon as I arrived in the unit. It was out in an area called Yakima Training Area, which is a high desert plateau. I arrived as a new green lieutenant, had a couple of experienced sergeants in the unit. I'm supposed to go from point A to point B as a new lieutenant, and of course, the sergeants acted like they couldn't read a map because they wanted the lieutenant to have to find a way to get there. Which, of course, being a new lieutenant, I was going to get lost. It was expected. So the sergeants kind of played with the new lieutenant. The lieutenant learned to listen to both his warrant officer and also listen to his first sergeant. and that's usually going to keep a new lieutenant out of trouble. We had some pretty interesting experiences. You'd stay up for two or three days in a row. I remember one morning after going through a couple of day and night operations, I parked my tank on a ridgeline, jumped out of my tank, walked right back to the tank behind me where they'd just now moved into position, looked into the tank, and all four members of the crew had fallen asleep, dead asleep, within just a matter of a few seconds after stopping. We at one point were working with an infantry unit. They wanted us to go to the top of this mountain, and we told them there was no way we could do it. Then it was a night movement. I actually led the night movement. We just kept climbing until we couldn't climb anymore, and we were turning back on ourselves. When we woke up that morning, there were eagles' nests around us, and we actually were on the top of that mountain that we had told that infantry commander that we couldn't reach. So maybe in the dark, you don't know what you can do. You can do maybe more than you can do in the daylight because you don't know any better. That was my first assignment in Fort Lewis, Washington. For any armor crewman, what is unique about armor, you have a tank qualification course, and the cumulative part of the training is qualifying your individual tank crew. Whether you're a division commander, down to the newest tank commander, every tank commander in the division has to qualify his individual tank, even a two-star general, even the division commander. So a whole year's worth of what you are as an armor crew member is all compressed down into 10 different engagements, each one of those engagements averaging about 15 seconds. So in the span of less than 2 minutes, what you are all about as an armor crewman is put on paper on a checklist and scored. So something unique about it, just a very small period of time, and it means the world for every one of the armor crewmen in the entire division. Our training was always at Fort Knox, Kentucky. That's the home of Armor Branch. As a new lieutenant, oftentimes as OCS graduates, we thought it would have probably been better if they'd have just given us the user's manual and put us on a plane and sent us to our unit. Because at Fort Knox, as new lieutenants, we had a pretty good tendency to, we partied a little bit, ate whatever we wanted to eat, and had a really good time while we were there and learned some. But as far as how shiny our boots were and how strack we looked in our uniform, probably fell off a little bit. But a real good time. Upon returning to Fort Knox as a captain for my senior training, armor training, had some great foreign officers, one from Australia that was outstanding, one from Egypt, one from Israel. So not only were we learning about our own tactical knowledge that we needed to learn, but we also learned about other officers and other friendly countries. My assignment coming out of Fort Knox was originally going to be to a NATO assignment in Arnhem, Netherlands, which is probably something that a new captain really wouldn't want. A new captain wants to go to a troop unit. I had another captain there who wanted to leave and go to earlier. So I picked up his course. It was a maintenance officer course. It kept me at Fort Knox for another 3 months. By staying there another 3 months, instead of landing in this NATO staff job in the Netherlands, I wound up in 1st Armored Division, Erlangen, Germany, right at the tip of the spear. I had an opportunity to be an adjutant, which is the personnel officer for the battalion, and then command a tank company forward deployed in Germany, which is the best job any Army officer could ever have. Company command in Europe in peacetime, when the dollar was strong. I think it was about 4.50 before I left. Later on, I had an assignment. I did have a NATO assignment. That was as a major. It was in Southern Europe in Naples, Italy, which was always a great place for anyone to come visit me. Always took them to Pompeii, took them up to Rome, to Florence. So very nice place. The wife loved it. Children loved it. While we were there, Of course, that was in the early 90s. This was in right after Desert Storm, 92, 93, 94. At that point, the situation in Bosnia had really heated up. NATO was becoming involved. We were sending our staff officers in and out of Bosnia and Croatia, looking at even moving our headquarters in. That was a job I had, to look at a place to put a forward headquarters in Croatia. But those of us assigned to NATO, it was just business as usual for us as NATO officers. The Army, Air Force, and Navy, and Marines who were moving in and out of our headquarters and moving into the area, in and out of the area, they were picking up an Armed Forces medal as well as a NATO medal. We, on the other hand, it was our job because of us being in that NATO assignment, so we didn't receive these two awards. So there was a little bit of quibbling among these officers, a little childish quibbling over not getting these badges, not getting these medals for or doing our job in the Bosnian theater in the early 90s. After I left my company command position, I'd been in the Army about 8 years at that point, and I'd really only planned to stay in the Army for 4 years, but I just couldn't pass up that assignment to Germany, an opportunity to command a tank company. I was looking at getting out, but my next assignment was at teaching ROTC in a small college in western Pennsylvania, another really nice assignment, another assignment my family loved. So I had the opportunity to be a college assistant professor of military science for 4 years, teach military history, which I love anyway, and had an opportunity to do that for 4 years. At that point, I'm past the halfway point towards retirement. My mother, exercising common sense, pretty much talked me into saying, if you've gone this far, go ahead and go the other 8 years and go ahead and make a career of it, which wound up being a NATO job and then another job in South Carolina, my last job in the services. I actually called my assignment officer up from Naples, Italy, told him to find Greenville, South Carolina on the map, which is my hometown, and asked him to find the closest job to Greenville, South Carolina he could for a major, an Army major. And he found one in Rock Hill, South Carolina, right up the road. So I finished out my career just down the road from my hometown, and actually stayed in the same house that I had moved in on my last duty assignment after retirement. I have a son who's now on week three at Parris Island. His first letter from Parris Island was very much like my first letter from Fort Benning. First line was, "This place is terrible," and 2 pages of just pretty much whining about conditions at Parris Island. Of course, the wife is all bummed out about her son not being all that happy. And of course, my response is, "He's at Parris Island. It's the first month. He's not supposed to be happy." We received his third letter now. He's in his third week, and he's starting to lighten up a little bit. He's beginning to like the place. Real proud. His unit's actually scoring the highest in the platoon in the company. So he's real proud about that. I'm a government and international studies major. I certainly know about the Soviet Union. I know the situation that existed between late fall of 1945 up until 1991. And it was the Soviet Union, our confrontation with the Soviet Union, which was the reason that I joined the Army in the first place. So I consider that Cold War commemorative medal to be a very important commemorative medal. As a Cold War veteran, we have both authorized medals, the medals that you had earned that would be on your discharge papers. We also have medals that commemorate certain events, such as our victory over the Soviets in the Cold War, as well as some medals that would be, say, for your ribbon-only awards. But we could take someone, a Cold War warrior, with their discharge papers and with their experience, with the units that they served in, and we can put together a very nice display case which reflects their service as a Cold War warrior and reflecting on how they serve for the common defense of this nation. A guy off the street who says, "Hey, the only medal I won was a National Defense Service Medal." Well, he raised his right hand during a time where he could have been at the tip of the spear at any moment. Even those who say, for instance, joined up in the services where we may have been involved in a conflict, such as Vietnam, a good example. He may have signed up during the Vietnam era, but he simply was not assigned to Vietnam. He raised his right hand and he was going to go wherever Uncle Sam told him to go. He was a Cold War warrior. All of our conflicts between 1945 and 1991 were oriented on containing the Soviet Union. He performed that duty in helping us contain the Soviet Union, whether or not he was in a hot zone. He still provided for our common defense, and he answered the call to duty. Yeah, I had an elderly gentleman walk in yesterday. He wanted to order some medals and ribbons for wear. And he had a Silver Star in his order, which is a high valor award, requires documentation for our file. So I asked him, he didn't have documentation, so I was just quizzing him a little, thinking that maybe I could find him on the internet. He said he served in 82nd Airborne. So I asked him, I said, well, what operations were you in? Battle of the Bulge or what? And he said, well, Market Garden. I asked him, well, then 82nd Airborne, Market Garden. So you were at 9 Megan Bridgehead. He said, yes, I actually went across the water with the troops crossing the river. And so I gained the information I needed for the Silver Star award. So that night while watching TV, there was a special on Market Garden on the History Channel, and he was actually being interviewed during the program. The program lasted about an hour, and he was in it for about 15 minutes. So that was great verification. I just met a war hero walking in the door yesterday afternoon. Another day at Medals of America. I actually answered an ad. I was looking at moving from Rock Hill back to Greenville, South Carolina. Had a possible opportunity as a teaching job. Saw an ad about Medals of America. Loved the time I'd spent in service. Thought it would give me an opportunity to possibly meet some of these heroes, which I have done both in person and over the telephone, and have an opportunity to serve veterans and their families, veterans of all services, veterans of all the different wars, actually even all the way back to World War I, for some surviving dependents of World War I veterans who are doing display cases for them. So I love the work, love the people I work with. It's a really good operation.